business that she started to validate the clients and empower them to overcome the frustrations of not feeling well, and the fears of present health conditions, which we all know that we all have that, right? A lot of people that talk to us that frequent this type of pharmacy, this sort of complementary type pharmacy, know that that's the type of thing that we, I've been sick in bed for 4 days, so I'm sorry. So that's why I'm usually fairly loud. I've come from a loud family, but if I'm not loud enough for you, I apologize. We can do things. We're going to have other people here helping us out, so I'm going to be going home, but there's other staff that will be here. We have the temperature set around 72, trying to make it comfortable. If anyone becomes uncomfortable, grab one of the people at the back and they can adjust it up or down. It's not the easiest room to control. She is going to be, Lisa does not have a handout. She's requested that everyone give a good email so that she can email you her handout at the end. I think there's lots of different things she's going to talk to you about tonight. Things that are close to our hearts are things like gluten intolerance and celiac disease. So that's really it for me. Just do a great job, and you guys enjoy, okay?
All right, so who hasn't signed in?
Thank you. Yeah, I just
thank
been here
you
all
very
day,
much.
So I have to get
it. Awesome. Always great to get in.
Sorry.
Yeah, all right. A little applause before you start. So as he said, I'm Lisa. I'm a nurse practitioner. My practice is in Hopkinton, Mass. It's great to see one of my past patients here. A couple of you I think I know as well. Maybe not, I didn't treat you directly. So I thank you for coming out, as you said, on a Thursday night, and I'm just thrilled that it's not last night, because I think y'all would have stayed in. So I am, you'll find that I'm extremely passionate about what I do, not because I am about me or about my business, but because I'm about making all of as many people as I can possibly tell that there's other way of medicine, that there is a true way to shift the body, a completely different paradigm of medicine. And I would love if you guys all left here and told three people what you heard tonight, even if it's one or two things. Just, can I ask that you raise your hand and promise me that? Three people? That's it. So that would give us a good 150 people that would hear the message of what functional medicine is and why we feel that it can really shift. And it's so doable, and it's not hard. And so a little bit about who I am. As he said, I'm a nurse practitioner. I've been in the healthcare field for 27 years. Nurse first in the military. I started out as an Army nurse, Desert Storm. I did, when I got out of the military, after traveling, I was in Germany, Hawaii, and Alaska. I was jobless, homeless, and pregnant, and drove across country from Alaska with my husband for my first child. I landed in Massachusetts, where we were both from, and from there I did my love of women's health, which was labor and delivery. I did grief counseling for perinatal loss, and I did a lot of childbirth classes, those kind of things. And in the midst of doing that, I found that I needed to do a little bit more in the actual helping people to get pregnant. So then I worked as a manager of an IVF center. And when I did that, I kept thinking, why is there so much fertility issue? What is going on in our society that it used to be 1 in 10 people and now it's 1 in 5 people? So it started even back then, and at that time my daughter was about a year old. I started looking for a different job, and she started having ear infections. So some of you may have experienced children with ear infections, and the first thing that they do is typically give an antibiotic, right? And so thankfully people like Johnson's Pharmacy have other options for ear infections. And so it was at that point that I really sort of got introduced to what we would call complementary or alternative integrative medicine. So one of my coworkers told me about chiropractic, and that if I used chiropractic that her ear infections would go away and then would come back. And I thought, so I thought, and I said, looked at her and said, well, why would they snap a little baby's neck? And she said, no, it's just a massage. You don't understand. And she told me about these stations, the whole atlas. And I looked it up, and back then, of course, it was a library, right? So I spent hours at the library, and I was like, wow, there is so much research out there about this. Why is this not common medicine? I'm in medicine. I don't know anything about it. So lo and behold, I brought her. She never got another ear infection. When she started to get ear infections, we brought her. They went away. Pediatricians kept saying that I was hurting her. Clearly I wasn't. So that was my first exposure to what we would call complementary therapy. My next exposure was, and then of course from there, my husband and I were like, this is crazy, this is awesome. We can keep her healthy and we can keep ourselves healthy. So any time that we ever got exposed to any kind of viral illness and we started to feel like we were getting run down, we would go to a chiropractor and we would just never get sick. If we did it, we last a day instead of six. From there, I had a real tragic event in my personal family. My brother's wife died suddenly, very tragically. And so between supporting him and myself being part of watching her in the emergency room, it was really traumatic. And so during that time frame, I wasn't sleeping, right? I mean, who does sleep when you're really horrified? And so it got to the point where it was me not sleeping at all, and I wasn't going to take medicine, but it was dangerous. And it was a friend that said, you should try acupuncture. So I said, what do I get to lose? So I went to the acupuncturist, and I slept through the night the next night. Of course, still sad and angry and worried and whatever. But at that point, I went back to her and said, I need to know how this works. And so she gave me a lot of information. And long story short, she introduced me to a way that I could help my patients in women's health, you know, with menopause and infertility and all these other things that we had experienced. So it was just really exciting for me to have these other things. And so tonight we're going to talk a little bit about autoimmunity, because I myself at one point was diagnosed with an autoimmune. And I don't know who here either knows somebody or is here with an autoimmune. And unfortunately, it's really kind of growing and growing and growing. And I want that to go the other way. So autoimmune disease, as you know, is the bucket term for a whole bunch of different conditions. Anything from skin condition to a joint condition to a heart condition to a brain condition, whatever conditions those are. In general, it's basically the body, basically hurting itself, thinking it's protecting us. So a little bit about me. Yes, that's me. Lifelong IBS, anemia, headaches, underweight. When I was in high school, I graduated at 114 pounds, the same height. So you can imagine, I'm not kind of big now, and I weigh 140. So I feel like it was a real disservice having my whole entire life having all these things, and nobody ever said, gee, let's just do a blood test on her and see if she has anything going on. So always tired, and then I myself, after that experience, actually experienced infertility myself. It didn't make any sense to me, because the first time, as I said, you know, we are pregnant, no problem, and here I was 6 years later saying, I don't understand what's going on. And it wasn't until my sister and I were up in Niagara Falls, I just had one child, and she had three, and one of her children was having a lot of belly aches, and she herself was having a lot of this bloating, and they kept blaming it on, you know, a 1 centimeter ovarian cyst, whatever it might be. I had never seen the bloating. And when I was with her, I saw this bloating, and I know that the look on my face scared her, because all I kept thinking is, oh my God, my sister has ovarian cancer. There's no way that that's normal. She went from being looking like this to looking 6 months pregnant in a matter of a couple hours. And she hadn't eaten, you know, we hadn't eaten anything here. So she had no GI issues whatsoever. So I looked at her and I said, we've got to figure out what's going on. So that, again, we were still at the library, there was no internet at that point, so we spent hours and hours and hours, and she went into her doctor and said, these are the four tests I want you to do, and he refused. Has anyone here ever had that happen? Okay. So she was really disappointed, because this is somebody that is a go-getter. She doesn't bug people with, you know, little things, and she said, I don't understand why you would refuse these four tests. You know, I've done a lot of research. She brought in paperwork, and he said, first of all, one test was for a condition that actually breaks down, you know, the gut. And so that to him wasn't anything to do with what she had. The other two tests, he said she had already had tested. But when I looked at all her lab tests, it hadn't been tested. Something similar had. And the last one, maybe it was only three tests, was a celiac panel. And he said, that's ridiculous. You're a normal weight. You have three kids and you've never had a GI issue in your life. And she said, yes, but what about all these other things? She was exhausted. She had anemia. She had a rash that never went away, which now we know is that celiac rash. And she had horrible allergies. Brain fog was so bad that she sometimes would forget things that were, like, you know, for those of us that are not normal, like, oh, where are my keys kind of things. And so when we did, so she went to a different doctor. Completely left that person, and I said, get a nurse practitioner. So she did, and that person said to her, I'm going to order it, but I can't guarantee that it's going to get paid for by your insurance, because I'm just going to put it down as a rash. And I said to my sister, I said, if that happens, then we're going to fight it because you also have this bloating that I've seen. Lo and behold, it was positive for her. So I said, well, holy crap, if you're positive and I have every single solitary symptom, so I was positive as well. So long story short, my mom was then positive, and 13 grandchildren, 9 are positive. So we have tested them. Only some of them had positive antibodies because a lot of them didn't, so we had them gene tested. So the reason I tell you that is because I'm not coming from a place of, let me tell you as a practitioner what I think is good. I'm telling you as a practitioner, I've been there, I've been doubted, I've been looked over. When I emailed my doctor portal message, and this was somebody, by the way, that I trained with in my nurse practitioner program, so it wasn't like I didn't know her, she knew that I was, had rain in my head. And I sent her a message and I said, you know, my sister was diagnosed with celiac, you know I have XYZ PDQ, would you mind, I just want the blood test. And she said, I'll do it, but you know you have to eat gluten-free if it's positive. And I was like, well, of course I know that. Why would I not do that? So, of course, it was positive. And then a year or two later, I was then teaching at UMass. I was teaching at UMass Medical School in the Family Nurse Practitioner Program. And I would sit in the back of the room during all the lectures. We had wonderful speakers from all over, and we were in an amazing center, huge medical center. So we would have speakers from every part, whether it be gastroenterology, pulmonary, dermatology, you name it, all the ologies. And one of the gastroenterologists, 3.5 lecture, I'm only giving you 45 minutes, this was 3.5 hours of lecture to these students. And the very last slide, off of a bullet, for a differential diagnosis with celiac. And this was an entire IBS slide. This is me. I said, excuse me, I'm really kind of blown away that that's like a bullet off of a bullet. You know, 1 in 100 people have celiac, and only 1 in 3,000 are diagnosed. So why would you not, number one, put that in the top of the differential diagnosis for IBS in like the second slide? And number two, why would you discount it to the point of, you know, you can test it if you want, but you don't always have to test it, or we don't always have to test it. Why would you do that? Does anyone have an idea of what his answer was? Expensive is a good answer. Actually, the blood test is very, very cheap. The, you know, endoscopy, those kind of things tend to be a little more expensive. Anyone else?
Want to know what to do?
Awesome. So he said, number one, nobody wants to eat like that. And number two, we really don't know what to do with that. And I'm sitting there like, and I just said to him, and I said, that's really a disservice to a lot of people. I'm hugely disappointed. This is a huge medical center. And I'm not going to get myself in trouble with my colleagues, with you, or all of my students. But I think that we should have a conversation. I'm happy to sit down with your gastroenterology unit. And so, lo and behold, what I ended up doing crazy is I went on a gluten-free diet. It's nuts. It's crazy. It's almost like Dr. Wall. Has anyone ever seen Dr. Wall? She's a musculoskeletal multiple sclerosis survivor. You know, she got almost disbarred because she was telling people to eat vegetables. Not even kidding, you can look it up. So this thing of like eating real food is really crazy voodoo medicine. So that's what I did, and within 2 weeks I was feeling much better. So a disease in which the body's immune system attacks healthy cells. So basically your body is actually really working correctly. It's just working too hard, and it's working against the things a little bit inappropriately as far as how much it's doing, where it's going, and how much it's attacking. And so approximately 50 million Americans, 20% of the population, 1 in 5 suffer from an autoimmune condition, and that's a lot of people. So when we look at that, unfortunately, 4 out of 5 of those people are women, and I'll get to some of why that is in a little bit. And so to put it in perspective, when we look at people suffering from breast cancer, that's 2.2 million compared to 50 million, 7.2 with heart disease compared to the 50 million. So now, the other thing is a lot of what's happening up above there with those 50 million are actually leading to some of the other things that are going on with the cancers and other things. So it would be great for you guys to get this inside secret, to know what kind of things may be triggering that, or you can decrease them so that you can maybe reduce everything that might be not so good for us in the future. So what I did was I put in, instead of autoimmune, I put it in an inflammation bucket, because we know that what triggers autoimmunity is inflammation. Now, are we able to say, ooh, that's where the inflammation is? Not always, sometimes. But inflammation, if you look at all of these conditions, whether they're autoimmune, cancer, dementia is an inflammatory condition, I would love for you to just peek at the map. So these maps, the darker, like the red and the dark blue and the yellow, you can see the developed countries, those that have, you know, all the processed foods, and we're working 24/7, and we're on our iPads all the time. So all these things that are all on, unfortunately are not doing so well with us as far as conditions, chronic conditions. And food for thought, it's kind of the same map for how much sugar we put in our body. So maybe there's one big trigger that might be leading to some of this in particular. So the autoimmune disease, this is the only thing cutting up to kick your tush. That's right, it's only you. So what I like people to understand when they leave here today and when I talk with my patients, what's going on is not bad. It's a bummer and it's difficult, but don't blame yourself, because really the immune system is kicking your ass because it's strong and it's really wanting to help you. And so all we have to do is redirect it to do it the right way. Instead of going off track, get it back on track. And it's really doable. And I think part of what happens when we get to the point where we're not feeling well, especially if there's more than one autoimmune, we almost give up on our body. We gotta stop doing that because it's not gonna help us. We've got to believe that we can get better. That's 80% of it. And I know that you can, because your immune system's still working. If it wasn't, you wouldn't have the autoimmune. So we kind of redirect. All right, so traditional medicine says, while there's no cure for autoimmune, physical therapy and medications can help slow disease's progression. This was literally, I just looked it up the other day when I was preparing. What this is, what it says about autoimmune. Well, I think that's a bunch of crapola. All right, so I'm going to give you two case studies. I'm not going to be boring like medical school, but I'm just going to give you, I'm going to start here and give you a couple, and then at the end I'll give you the resolution and what the outcome was for these two particular women that I picked. Of course, we've had many and we've had men, and but these women in particular gave me the okay to actually give you guys the case. So Rebecca is one of my long-term patients. She's been a patient of mine now for 8 years. And she came to me with rheumatoid arthritis, had been diagnosed 4 years prior. When she was first diagnosed, it was very vague. So as you can imagine, for the first year and a half, it was, you're getting older, it's just probably you worked up too hard, you probably just need to sleep in a different bed. Does this sound familiar? So take some ibuprofen, all your tests are normal, right? All the tests are normal. And so she just was like, I know something's not right. So she, of course, woke up one day, both her shoulders, her elbows, and wrists were to the point where she could barely move them. And they said, oh, well, it's probably Lyme, but that was negative. So they gave her a bunch of medicine. And it still was another like 3 to 6 months before they diagnosed her with RA. And so here she was. Now she came to me on three different medications with symptoms that were getting worse. And at that point, she had just started an IV medication. She was getting IV medications. It was every 4 weeks. And they were just going up and up and up on the dose. And they were saying now that they were thinking they were going to have to get down to like every 2.5 to 3 weeks. Or add a fourth medication. So she was talking to somebody who was talking to somebody else who was talking to somebody else who somehow knew me, because she's down near the Cape. And I live in Milford. And she found me. And she said, I don't mean to get better. This is how she said it, which made me kind of cry. I just don't want to keep getting worse. And she said, my daughter's pregnant and I will not be able to hold my grandbaby. And that, there's no way I was letting that happen. And that's where lifestyle and life gets in the way, right? Granted, it's uncomfortable. Granted, you have to take pills. Autoimmune or any condition is really a pain in the tush. But when it affects the joys of your life that deeply, you've got to fix it. And she said, I just want to be able to make sure I can hold my grandbaby. And I looked at her and said, oh, well, we're going to do more than that. We're going to get you off most of your meds. We're going to get you better. So anyway, so she just wanted to be able to do that. And she's a cook. So she works in one of the school systems as a chef. And so she was getting to the point where she's like, I'm going to have to stop working, which of course, you know, 54 is young financially to be able to have to do that. This is Lily. She's 21 years. I did change her name. She asked me to change her name, but she's adorable. She's actually a daughter of a nurse friend of mine that I used to work with. She, the nurse friend of mine sent me an email one day and said, hey, I hear you're doing something different, because she was a labor and delivery nurse with me. She goes, you're doing something different, quotes, like I'm kind of like making up my medicine. And I would love to talk to you if you see if you can help Lily. And I said, okay, well, why don't you, you know, have her come in. So she came in, and I looked at her, and I said, listen, this is going to be really weird. I'm going to ask you things like when you were born, were you breastfed, did you have a bunch of antibiotics, things that might be a plotted part of it, which is what we do in functional medicine. We do almost like a timeline. You know, was it a happy home? Did you ever have abuse? Did you ever fall down and get a concussion? Because that's just an opening of leaky gut and intestinal permeability. And so we did all of that. She was on her fourth medication for ulcerative colitis. She was a college student. And when the mom had reached out, it was finals time frame. It was actually like this time frame a couple of years ago. And the more that she would get stressed, the more that she would see that she would have more pressure eating. And so they, the day that they came to me, what, they were coming to me at 9 a.m. and they had an appointment at 1 p.m. at Children's Hospital. And the appointment at Children's Hospital was to either add another medication, but the doctors told her the visit prior to that, that more than likely she's going to have some of her rectum removed, some of her colon removed, so that she'd have to have surgery in part of her bowel taken. And so the mother looked at me and said, I'm not against it. I just really would like to say that I tried everything first. And I said, we're not doing surgery. We're not taking out, she's 21. I don't want that to happen to a 61-year-old. So in functional medicine, we go to what's, anyone ever heard of functional medicine? Raise your hand. Oh, good. Well, you're in Johnson's Pharmacy. So functional medicine is root cause, which means that we don't say, this is what your disease is, take this pill for it. We say, oh, you have that disease? What are the symptoms? Let's see what those symptoms are coming from and find out why those are happening. And it may be one of a bunch of different things. And my colleague, I work with a physician, her name's Dr. Patizel, she's like, let me see your slideshow for tonight. And so I showed her today. She said, never forget the gut because she forgets, or because she heals. And I said, yeah. She goes, where'd you get that? I said, I made it up. So I just made that up. Because I'm one of those people that when I study, I have to kind of have an algorithm to remember all the words. So when I'm talking to patients, I'm like, okay, you know, did I go over? And then this is just really easy, and I think for you, this will be on the handout that I send to you guys. So some of these things, well, not everything because that's boring, but I'll make sure that I send things, and certainly whatever questions you have, I'm going to make sure that I send along for you. So never forget the gut because she heals. So you start with nutrients. So we're going to make sure that people's nutrients are healthy. And I'm going to go each one. Do they have food sensitivities? And those are a little bit different than allergies, right? So I have an allergy to gluten. But I also have, unbeknownst to me, many, many food sensitivities. And so then we work on toxins. And that isn't necessarily, I'm being exposed to a whole bunch of things all the time. More so, what am I not exporting? So it's one of both. So am I getting exposed, which we all are a little bit, right? And even if we try to really control it. But maybe your body just doesn't do as good a job getting rid of some stuff. And then the gut, of course, which we'll get into. Bugs can be infections, low-lying, even something like someone has a cold sores and they have like that low-lying herpes bug. And it may be something like varicella, right? So how many people here have heard someone that they had this, and this happen, and then all of a sudden they got shingles? Well, that's because their immune system was doing all that, and they forgot to check all the door locks for all the other things that they've been keeping at bay for so long. And then stress, hormones, and that's my algorithm. So we'll start with nutrients. So unfortunately, the standard American diet is very high in calorie, as you saw, very high in sugar, very high in processed carbohydrate for the most part. Some people, you know, carbohydrates include vegetables, which in some fruit, but that's not what I'm talking about when I say carbs. And then, unfortunately, pretty low in nutrients. So that means that what we're eating, unfortunately, is really high in consumption and filling our belly and getting the hold of being not so hungry, but we're not looking at what is in that food that goes in our body. and think about how much, and that's not just food, that's also drinks, right? So your drinks that are loaded with sugar, or dyes or whatever else might be in them that are chemical driven. So when you think about what goes in your mouth, that's how many times a day, like 10 to 12 times a day, between food and drinks. And so that's a lot of exposure to your immune system, because your immune system sits right along the entire gut. 75% to 80% is in the gut. And even if you do, like you look at a lymph node CAT scan, that's where all your lymph nodes are too. And so thinking about that. So the other thing is that when you're looking at nutrients, and I'll get to the second bullet in a second, but when you're looking at nutrients, you need to put them in your body. So when I have, this is my favorite, when people tell me that they're a vegetarian, and I'm just like, oh, that's awesome. And then I look at their food and I say, wait a second, are you a vegetarian or are you a carbitarian? Because I don't see any vegetables. It's all pasta and cereal and whatever it might be. So making sure that what you're putting in is full of color, and mostly it's like what the whole food is, right? So instead of being six and seven different things squeezed together that somebody else put together, it's actually the food that came from a produce department or a farm stand or something like that, that you're able to actually make food with, right? Putting it together yourself, like a stir fry. You then have to absorb the nutrient. In order to do that, you need to actually break down that nutrient, the food in your belly, right? So it starts with chewing. Raise your hand if you do that. I don't. Most of us don't, and that's the only place that we have control with digestion, right here. All right, so this is it. So here and here, and yet we don't do it. So that's the only thing that we do, and really we're supposed to be doing like 10 to 15 chews for every single bite. And then we're also not supposed to guzzle this entire glass of water while we're doing it, because we go choo-choo-choo to get it down the hatch. But what that's doing is completely diluting our stomach acid. And so think of it like if you were going to clean with a cleaner that you might buy at the store, which you won't because that's full of toxins. We'll get to that in a second. But say you were going to do that. You brought it home and you have this really, really, really greasy tablecloth, and you dump 80% of it out and put in all water. And then you go to clean it, and clearly it's not going to do as good a job. So that's what's happening in your gut when you drink a bunch of fluid with your meals. So not only are we not chewing, but we're also really reducing the stomach acid that's supposed to be pulling apart our proteins to make our amino acids and pulling off those minerals from the food. The other thing chewing does is signals the pancreas to send out digestive enzymes. Anyone ever heard of those? I'm guessing half of you are on them. So digestive enzymes come from the pancreas, and those actually do more than one thing. So they, if you think about digestive enzymes, it's actually the chewing. They get there almost kind of the same time, if not before, and then they actually pull apart or denature the food, and then stomach acid sort of cuts it up. While that's happening, it's also signaling the pancreas to start sending out insulin. Hello. So not only are we eating too much, or eating too fast, or eating way too many carbs, we're drinking down our stomach acid, so we're not breaking down the food, we don't have any signal for insulin. So when it gets in there, we have so much high glycemic food and no insulin to get there to work on it. And then it goes, oh, we need insulin. It gets there and it's a little bit too late. And so can you see the cascade of what's going on here? And high insulin, high sugar, is a huge trigger for all chronic condition, including autoimmune. And so we have to absorb it. The next thing we have to do is we have to assimilate it, which means that we have to actually recognize it in our body and get it into our cells. And things like magnesium, vitamin D, the two top nutrient deficiencies in our country. And magnesium is essentially the lock for every single cell. So if you have a low magnesium, you're like getting 50% of what you're eating, even if you're eating the best diet. And so thinking about what's going on there, the last thing that happens when you're talking about nutrients is how long it stays in your body. So for some people, we have the constipated people that it's there for 3 weeks. And then you have the other people that it's there for 3 hours. And so where in there are you getting optimal nutrients, right? Obviously, it should be about 12 to 24 hours. Too much? Doing okay? All right. So thinking about that, when you get your labs done at a normal doc, everything's normal. All right, let's just stop there for a second. B12. Anyone have a B12 deficiency? Okay. So B12, normal, you know what the level's at? and most labs are like 190 to, or even, they could even be as low as 150, but most of them are about 200 to 1100. So I have his daughter, Vasile, had her labs done, called the nurse. Can I have the results? Oh, they're all normal, you're good, they're all normal. I'm like, yeah, but can you just, like, do the results, like, what the numbers? Well, they're normal, and I said, I'm a nurse practitioner, I just want the numbers, I just want the numbers. And she's like, oh, okay. So she said, okay, so the vitamin B12 is 194, and I'm like, oops, I'm sorry, what? And she said, it's 194. I said, what is the reference range for your B12? And she said, 200 to 1100. And I said, well, then that's not normal. She said, well, it's just under, it's fine. Okay. This is a chick who's anxious. Anxiety and B12 go hand in hand. So I said, well, to be honest with you, that's really kind of a D minus F. And so I'd really like my daughter to be a B+. So in your, just in the future, can you make sure that if you tell anyone it's normal, that you actually tell them that it's actually not normal? So that was one. Her D, normal is usually anywhere, depending on labs, they've changed it now. That used to be 10 to 80. They've now shifted, most labs are 30 to 100. And so her D was normal. It was 24. The ferritin's the best one. So ferritin is your iron stores, and iron, of course, is, you know, trigger for everything in your body. Energy, it also goes in the neurotransmitter pathways for mood, sleep. It also is really important for fatigue, right? Everyone knows that when they're anemic, they're tired. And pain, so B12, B's and iron are for that. Hair and thyroid. And so here's this, you know, 14-year-old athlete, and she's got a B12 deficiency, in my opinion, a D deficiency, in my opinion. Her ferritin normal is anywhere from 30 to, like, 700. Again, why is there a range like that, right? So hers was 31. So here's a celiac who we know has an issue with being able to, just by nature of the disease, even if you're eating gluten-free, you do have less of an ability to get the nutrients and assimilate them. You can eat them, you can absorb them, but they may not be getting into the cells. So another good story about that is those people that go to their lab and they've had their multivitamin that day and they get their blood drawn and everything's normal. But really what you're testing is your vitamin. So if, what you test in your serum blood is what you've had that day, usually the last week, say, to eat or as a supplement. So I have all my patients eat whatever you're eating, that's great, but your supplements you need to stop for the week before you go get your labs drawn. Because if you're checking D, especially fat-soluble vitamins like D, D is, you know, you can take 10 of those in once a week, and that's because it takes so long to absorb them. So that's the other thing with nutrients, is to make sure that what you're testing is really what's in your body. In functional medicine, we use red blood cell serum blood testing, which actually is 3-month average. So if you look at someone's 3-month average, I don't care what you took for supplements, and what you ate yesterday or the last week or the week before may not be the same as what you ate 2 weeks ago, but you know what your body has actually gotten into the cells and assimilated. So it's pretty cool stuff, okay? All right, so less of this, which is the norm. Don't eat through the car window. None of the packets with color. And if you can't pronounce it, don't eat it. Those are easy. And then a lot more of this. So real food, right? So food that you actually hopefully are making at home. If not, I get this all the time. I don't have time. And believe me, I have my own business. I have 3 kids that last lacrosse season, last spring, my husband and I counted, we went to 79 lacrosse games between the 3 of them. Granted, we split and conquered some of them, but that, I mean, I'm not a, I don't sit around and knit. So I know what it's like to be on the run. And so basically, if I don't have time and I'm on the run, I don't go to Subway or McDonald's or any of the other places. We run into, and literally, in the cleats and whatever else, into the grocery store and we grab a handful of carrots and the hummus and we get back in the car. And so there's ways that you can do it if you don't have time. All right, so food sensitivities. Way different than food allergy. So the allergy part, it can be 2 different categories. So there are some people like myself who have an actual allergy to gluten, which is a different thing, that's an autoimmune. Then there's people that have an allergy, which is a histamine reaction that they can actually die if they eat a food, right? You know, they get really bad hives and throat, that kind of thing. And those are things that are histamine related, which is histamine saves your life. Whereas IgG is your immune system. It's 2 totally different things. IgG is your immune system. So when you get repeated exposure to it, the immune system checks it out and decides whether or not it's friend or foe. So thinking of how all of us, pretty normal looking people, we all look great. So I take one of you and we go to the airport every single day at the same time, three times a day, 7, noon, and 6. We go to the same door and we walk through the same door. We go through the security. How many days do you think it's going to take before we get pulled over? 3, maybe, tops? Because when you go to an airport, you're supposed to go and not come back. You're not supposed to go through security 3 times a day, you know, potentially wearing the same outfit. Weird. That's not normal. They're going to come around. It's what the immune system's doing for food sensitivities. For some reason, that food is triggering an alarm, and they're starting to go, watch that guy, and then, oop, that guy's not okay. We want to attack that guy. And you're going to cling on to that guy, and wherever that guy goes, you're going to attack that too. So that could be your brain, that could be your thyroid, that could be your skin, that could be your joints, right? So wherever those go, that's where it goes. So that's when people say, well, I can't have food sensitivities, I don't have anything wrong with my belly. And I said, yeah, but you've got psoriasis that I can't even look at. So we need to fix that. And so when you think about that, whenever I see anything autoimmune, we know there's something going on in gut. It may not be food sensitivities, but that's one of the things that we're going to test. And then I think about it as the DEFCON level. So again, I was in the military, so I think about what level of readiness is going on in your body. Are you a level 1 freaking out to the food, or are you level 5? And when we do food sensitivity testing, it's usually 1, 2, or 3. And maybe someone's eating a ton of the ones every single day, 4 times a day. Well, if that's the case, you might want to kind of cut that down to once a week. If you're eating and a whole category lights up, and they're all 3 top ones, what do you think they are?
Dairy.
Wheat. Great. So it's bread, wheat, gluten. I'm going to put gluten in that bucket. Eggs. Good. Those are the top 3. And then now corn and soy are right there hand in hand. So those are the 5 that are the top. Okay. So Dr. Alessio Fasano is an Italian researcher who now works in Boston. He's a big guy who discovered zonulin, which I'll get to in a second. But this is his statement about genetic predisposition, miscommunication between innate and adaptive immunity, exposure to environmental triggers, loss of intestinal barrier function, secondary to the activation of zonulin by food-derived environmental triggers or changes in the gut microbiota, which is your bacteria that's healthy and not healthy in the gut, all seem to be key ingredients involved in the pathogenesis of inflammation autoimmunity. So when I have someone test for gluten and they're negative, that's their ticket to say, oh good, I can eat my bread again. Mm-hmm. And I say, and they can't. So if you truly have autoimmunity, you're only producing more zonulin, and you're only potentially feeding the fire of autoimmune. And so I just don't think a little bit of gluten with autoimmunity is going to help you. And it's really not that hard to avoid these days. It's way different than it was 12 years ago when I switched over. So that zonulin is sort of this protein that is made to actually open the intestinal barrier, to open those junctions to allow nutrients to get into the bloodstream and then close back up again. But unfortunately, the more inflamed somebody is and the more their immune system is not working well, vitamin D, your vitamin D works like a hairband to kind of pull that back together. If you're low in that, it's not as fast. For some people eating gluten, your intestines, junctions might be open 2 minutes. For other people, it might be 2.5 weeks. So when they come in, they say, well, I can't figure out what I'm eating that makes me have XYZ, whether it be skin or bowels or whatever, headaches. And I say, well, that's because it could have been something you ate last week. You know, it's not necessarily going to be today, which is totally different with IgG. Unfortunately, gluten triggers the release of zonulin in every single solitary human, and how much zonulin you make is different, unique to person to person to person. And just quickly, so what this is the intestinal cells, and then this is the bloodstream. Now, God did, and I'm using God, but whoever your person is that you follow, did a pretty great job creating. We are pretty awesome, right? Why do we have 7 cells on our skin and only 1 in our gut? Sorry. there's some things that I would like to change in the health development of this body. And so I just find it really interesting. We are costing it 7 to 10 to 12, 15 times a day with whatever we're drinking and eating, right? Why is there only one cell? So you can imagine how easy it would get to really break that down. And this is where that whole leaky gut comes in, right? You guys have heard that term maybe. Intestinal permeability is another way to think of it. So for those of you that haven't heard of it, what that means is instead of having a bowl, or for that matter, a really good thick sponge, like those brand new ones that are really awesome, you take them out and they don't even barely bend, and it takes a while for them to get filled up, and then when you squeeze it, you have to work really hard, and those are awesome, right? Instead of that little floppy thing that goes woo and it doesn't even hold water, or for that matter, a strainer. So depending upon how damaged someone's gut is, we have a really healthy, strong, brand new sponge, or we have a strainer. And that strainer is not only putting food into the immune system that's freaking the immune system out, because everywhere that blood goes and everywhere that it touches, it's going to get affected, but it's also putting things like bugs and other sort of alarm systems in, might be chemicals even. And so that's what that picture is. It's supposed to be the gut. The T is toxins, and I don't know how many of you have looked and seen the difference between what we have today in our society as far as, you know, exposure to chemicals versus it was even just, you know, this is 100 years ago. But I've done research in the last like 30 years. We've introduced something like, I think it was 100,000 in the last 10 years, and they're grass. So grass is generally recognized as safe by the FDA, whether you're eating them or putting them around your skin or whatever. But they're never tested together, because you can't research something without taking all other things out, right? So if we're gonna test something on a child, all the children have to be 12. They all have to be of the same size. They all have to be of the same health. They can't be on a medication. They have to be able to sleep every day, poop every day, whatever it might be. And that's the same for any study that they do. They try to take out these parameters that might falsify or change some of the results. So you can't take 5 different chemicals, or for that matter, 100,000 chemicals, and put them all together and test somebody, because you don't know what that reaction is coming from. So in my opinion, basically they haven't been tested for our safety. And then there's the sugar substitutes, the dyes, the high fructose corn syrup, BHT, other things that are in our food, and our household exposures, cleaning, health and beauty products. Fluoride's a big one. Most of us have fluorinated water at home. And if you do, I would recommend you don't drink that. And then it's just really hard on the, it's like kind of thinking like, geez, there's a little teeny ant, and so we get the entire bulldozer to get the ant. And so what that's doing is really freaking out the immune system. And then BPAs, which I'll get to in a second, which are xenoestrogens. And then, as I said before, this may not be that you're getting exposed too much on a daily basis, which some of it is, but it might be that we're not exporting them. So some of us, myself included, have an issue with getting them out properly and quickly in the right pathway in our body. And then don't even get me started on the whole mercury filling thing. Even though they say it's fine, it's just silly that we can't touch a thermometer, but we can have it in our mouth. So then bugs would be the whole microbiome, and that's the gut. So for those of you that haven't heard of it, there's something called the Microbiome Project. It's actually a huge NIH project right now, and you can look it up, the Microbiome Project, and I think it might even just be .org, if you can look that right up. It's huge, and there's not a medical course right now going on that doesn't speak the something on the microbiome, doesn't have some kind of a class. I went to a class myself with the physician I work with in September at the Harvard Medical School. Nutrition put it on. It was 2 full days. Every 30 minutes, a different researcher from around the world. When I say around the world, there isn't a part of the world that wasn't represented there. I can only understand half of them, but the slides were all in English, so that was good. But the entire thing was on how the microbiome affects health. 2 full days, every 30 minutes, at least 30 different presenters. So we're talking, you name it, it's the microbiome is in charge. And so when you think of how many cells we have versus how many cells that are in there, you want them to all be kind of happy and not have bullies in there sort of overtaking. I always tell my patients, it's like you want that cute little dog that comes and barks and then kind of goes, I think I know you, I think I don't, okay, I don't. Okay, bark, 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 bark. And if you do, then it goes, okay, well, I love you. And then it lets his little puppy friends play. But otherwise, it's a bunch of Cujos, and that's not helping us. And then some of them are helpful, some of them are not, but we want the ones that are helpful to overpower those that are not and sort of police those. And then some of them can be actually pathogenic. So I've had a few patients, actually Rebecca was one of them. I did a stool test on her, and even though she had no GI issues whatsoever, she thought until she stopped eating gluten, dairy, and I fixed her gut, and then she's like, oh my gosh, I've never been so skinny. And she had gained weight, but it wasn't weight, it was all inflammation and, you know, all the stuff that her belly had held on to. She had a parasite, actually. So we were able to find that and treat it with herbs. Then there's other things that our body actually produces, these little big medical terms I put in there. And the reason I put that there is because sometimes people come to me and say, you know, I just feel like my brain is not right. And I'll say, oh, there's something being produced in her body that's causing a chemical that her body's actually producing that is making her brain not work right. And then, again, the playing in charge. So this is just a little funny about healthy and not healthy bacteria, who's in charge and who's the guys in what playground. And when we work with the gut, we work with the 5-R approach, which means that we remove, we replace, we re-inoculate, repair, and rebalance. And I'm going to send you a slide specific to this so you understand what that means. But basically what that means is that we remove the stuff that isn't good, right? So that might be, you know, it might be broccoli. Maybe your food sensitivity is that you eat way too much broccoli, and your body says, oh, that's an enemy. But most of the time, it's one of those five things that we talked about before. We want to replace the things that are missing, like stomach acid, digestive enzymes, other things that might not be there. We want to re-inoculate with all the good bacteria and basically, hopefully, kill off the bad. And then we repair the gut, because you can't just take things out. So let's use me as an example again. So I was diagnosed with celiac. After about 2 weeks, 80%, 90% of my symptoms went away. But there was that 10 to 15% that didn't. I was still pretty anemic, and I still had pretty bad brain fog. And my mom had been diagnosed with celiac, with dementia out of nowhere. And she went from being this beautiful, regal, smart woman to wheelchair bound within a year and completely nonverbal. And then she passed away at 66. So here I am, 42 years old, and I'm watching my mother's brain, basically, you know, marbles kind of going all over the place, and she got no marbles, and I'm thinking, oh, this isn't good. I have forgetfulness, brain fog, finding things in places that they didn't belong and not remembering how they got there. Not just forgetting where you parked, but literally not even knowing what car you bought. So I thought, this is bad. So I went to the doctor, and she said, oh, it's just because you're busy. It's just because of this. I mean, all the labs are normal. So I went to a functional medicine practitioner, and she looked at me and shook her head and said, I'm so sorry about your mom. She said, nobody should have dementia. It's a preventative disease. It's just inflammation. And I immediately went, okay, well, what's going on? My brain is clearly inflamed. So it turned out that I had severe nutrient deficiencies. I had other food sensitivities that had never been found. I had difficulty exporting toxins with some methylation detoxification pathway issues. Those are big words, but just the way you export stuff. And then I also had high metals. Guess what? I had 7 amalgam fillings in my mouth. Mm-hmm. So when she tested my metals, she said she had never in her 20 years seen higher levels. So I thought, oh, crap. So I got all that fixed, and now I'm as smart as I think I'm ever going to get. I don't know. So I'm almost 50, and I'm healthier than I was at 28. So I want people to feel that way. I want them to feel empowered that they can get better. Sure, I'm going to get old and things are going to happen. But what they did was also said, you took out the stuff that was bothering you, but I never knew that I was supposed to be taking a probiotic for celiac has certain things that you have to do. And then I never knew that I was supposed to heal that sponge, right? I still had the strainer. So I was never told that. Traditional medicine doesn't teach that. And then we rebalance, which is something else we don't do. So rebalancing is about getting us to take the stress away, the S part. So we're really great about talking about how stressed we are. No, you don't get it. Like, not only was there a thing on the pie, but then there was this, and my kid has this, and my mother, and my mother-in-law, don't even get me started, my mother-in-law. And then I had 20 people at Thanksgiving, and then, you know, this broke. And it's like, the more stressed you are, the cooler you are. And so it's really actually uncool, and you feel guilty if you decide you're going to read a book, or maybe listen to music, and we call it meditation, or we can call it just zenning, whatever you want to call it. You might want to go and get a massage. It's really neat. Don't leave everyone else behind. So all these things that are helpful, Reiki, craniosacral therapy, acupuncture, yoga, walking in the woods, those are all stress reduction. For that matter, journaling, coloring books. Do you know how many coloring books I get on a weekly basis? Here's your adult coloring book. I need your color 1 hour, 15 minutes a day. Things that are just taking away the stress, because even if you have to pay someone, some of us don't know how to meditate. And so I say, then go pay someone. And, community acupuncture, it's like 15, 20 bucks a pop. If you're gonna pay your cell phone, which we all know how expensive those are, you gotta pay for the other stuff too. And then the whole cell phone part is another whole story. I mean, we don't sleep enough in our society. We just think it's okay to keep pushing. Eating and sleeping are sort of like things that we do when we can fit it in our schedule. But those things are really hugely important. Those are the most important things. So we talk about rebalancing. The other thing that stress does that people don't realize is, number one, somebody here had mentioned something about earlier about adrenal fatigue. And so that's when your adrenal glands, which sit on top of your kidneys, two tiny little guys that control the entire world of your body, they turn you on, they get you going, they give you energy, they wake you up in the morning, they go to sleep at night. Some people aren't, they're exhausted, but they're wired, right? Tired and wired. And then they also help you to work with your hormones. They're controlling your hormones. They're controlling the thyroid. So they're controlling a lot, these little teeny tiny things. But unfortunately, what happens is when this chronic stress is going on, even if it's all good, happy stress, I love my job, even if I'm working 80 hours a week, my kids are all awesome, I'm going to 79 games in a season, all those things are great. But if you don't purposely shut down, you're actually taking away that lining that you saw in that picture. Those little fingers get shorter and shorter and shorter and shorter. So that secretory IgA, which is protecting you, goes away. So it's all connected. So we want to make sure we fix that. All right, so then hormones. Hormones are the H piece. And so we want to make sure you're healing, and so we do want to make sure we hit each one of those little, so the HPA axis is the hypothalamus, pituitary, adrenal gland axis. It also goes to the T. I like to say HPAT, which is the thyroid. And so those all are talking to each other, and they're all part of the autoimmune condition and diseases. Vitamin D is a hormone. I don't know if anyone here knew that. I'm sure some of you did. But vitamin D is a hormone, and it's a fat-soluble hormone, and you need enough cholesterol in your body in order to actually have that there. So if you have a gut issue that you're not absorbing fats, and then you also have a statin, well, there goes your vitamin E, and there goes your hormones, because all your hormones are made from cholesterol. Mm. And then, menstrual fluctuations are just a normal thing that happens in women. So when I talked about women being 4 out of 5 people that have autoimmune, it makes sense, right? Because from the ages of, it used to be 16, but now it's like 10, and until like 50-ish, those are coming and going every single day. It's didactic. There's usually not a day that's the same. And so it makes sense that hormone fluctuations are a piece, right, of this this whole thing here. And then cortisol, again, we talked about it a second ago, but let's talk about chicks. So I'm going to tell a story about going to bed. This has happened about maybe 6 months ago. I'm sitting there, trying to finish, whatever I am on the computer. And I shut the computer, and it's maybe 9:30, and they're watching my kids like that Middle and Modern Family. It's like the only one that I actually know, so I watch that. And so it's the end of the show, and my husband gets up and goes, all right, I'm going to go to bed. And he went up and went to bed. Okay. So I said, yeah, me too. So I get up, and I went into the kitchen. I emptied the sink, made sure the dishwasher was filled, and I started that. And I ran downstairs, and I put a little laundry in. I came back upstairs, and I checked my phone for the next day. And the phone for the next day had something that I needed to pass in, like a permission slip. So I got that out, and I wrote the check, and I filled out the permission slip, which also made me remember that I had to do something else. So I got on the computer real quick and got that done. And then when I went upstairs, I noticed that the kids had left whatever, right? Does it sound familiar? So, and then we are also almost always the ones that do the phone call to so-and-so to check in on them and make sure that the birthday gifts are done or whatever it might be. And it's not that we're holding the badge of honor, but we tend to sort of carry that. And we feel guilty if we actually ask somebody else to do something. Part of it might be because we're a little bit kind of controlling. They might not do it right. And so this may be part of the reason that chicks have more of it, right? And then the xenoestrogens, which I Thank you. Okay, good. So xenoestrogens are these estrogen mimickers, we call them, which means that they're actually pretending to be estrogen. And you can see on the right-hand side, I put a little sciencey slide in there for you, but it shows you that estrogen is supposed to bind into a cell. All hormones are communicators. They don't actually carry things. They actually send a message. So, and that's supposed to click onto something else, which sends a message to something else. Think of it like a text message. So it has to go through, and it has to be received. And so xenoestrogens actually block that. So you're in the middle of nowhere with T-Mobile instead of, wherever you are with Verizon. And I had that experience recently. We're in the middle of a lacrosse thing, like, I can't get a hold of anyone in my family. This isn't working here. So what I showed you pictures of is the things that people are using kind of on a daily basis that have these xenoestrogens, these plastics that are hidden in things. And then also, this is another great slide that shows you sort of our household. And when you get back to women again, and I'm not just counting men, because men have just as much of this, the exposure tends to be a little higher with women. Things like your fragrances, men, they might put on deodorant and then they're out the door. Whereas women have to smell nice, have to look pretty, they have to have all their different, fluffy, whatever. So you think about how many things that they're doing on a daily basis, 12 products, over, I think it's the study said 160, 170 products, chemicals, before you walk out the door to work every day. And so when you think about that, right, so you get your shampoo, there's probably 15 in that, and then your conditioner, and guys use the shampoo for the whole body. They just wash their head and then the soap goes down and done. But we have to have the shampoo and the conditioner, and you might need to have a post, leave-in conditioner, and then you have to have the shampoo, and then you have to have the shaving cream, because you can't just use shampoo for that. And then you come out and you have to have the soap and lotion for all the parts that you did, and then you have to have the face cream and the eye cream and the whatever creams. And then you have to have the gel and you have to have the whatever hairspray if you do that. And then you forget about putting on the face. And the guys might use chapstick. and so the good thing is that we have less skin cancer, but they have more melanoma and skin cancer because we use all of those potions and lotions and sunscreens that have the SPF whatever, but we're also being exposed to those chemicals. So you look at that. So we don't realize how many we're doing, but we're also the ones, not all the time, my husband's amazing, he cleans all the time. But for for a lot of times in a lot of households, women tend to be the ones that are purchasing and using the cleaners more often. And prior to knowing any of this, I used to love opening the dishwasher and that last time. And now I'm like, I can't even go to Target, aisles. It smells so strong and terrible. And so all of those are exposing us. And of course, herbicides and pesticides, right? So I can't tell you to eat organic all the time. It would be lovely if we all could. But I always go with that EWG's Clean 15, Dirty Dozen Clean 15. My kids eat 100 apples a week. I'm not kidding. And so in that, I make sure that they never eat. Apples are always on the Dirty Dozen list. So I make sure that I get them the things that they're eating the most often. So strawberries are almost always on the Dirty Dozen list, but they might eat strawberries 3 times a year, fresh strawberries. We eat a lot of frozen, but we get the organic frozen. Okay. this is just a little funny. I warned you about the hormones and all that meat and dairy you eat. You can't see it, but you also have a tail, which is really So 4 out of 5, I talked the reasons why some of that's happening, and this is just a little slide showing the exact statistic of how many is there to hear, and this one was put up by 23andMe. Leaky gut, we talked a lot about, but it's also connected to, and I wanted to put this in here because that slide at the beginning that talked about autoimmune, cancer, and dementia, most of my patients come to me for a couple different reasons. The main one is either IBS or autoimmune, which are hand in hand, really, right? And then we have those people that are they're getting sicker and more comfortable and more tired and they're losing more life, but they're not finding answers. So those people might come into other categories that something else is going on that we find. It might be adrenal fatigue, it might be thyroid, whatever. And then we have that 10 to 15% of metabolic syndrome. And that metabolic syndrome are the people that have the triad of typically obesity, heart disease, which comes with high blood pressure, high cholesterol, and then diabetes. And so that metabolic syndrome goes hand in hand with leaky gut. There's multiple studies out there. So when people come to me, we actually were interviewed by CNN. If you go on our website, you can find Betsy's interview. She came to me as a diabetic, and reason she came to me, 64, I think she was diagnosed like 8 years prior, and they told her, over and over again, just so you know, the trajectory is that it's going to get worse. The older you are, the worse it gets, and almost everybody ends up on insulin at some point, blah, blah, blah. And her trajectory was just that. Her numbers were getting worse, even though she was taking the medicine. She wasn't exercising as much as she should. She wasn't eating as clean as she should. She admitted, I know some of it's my fault, but I don't think I'm that bad. Why is it getting worse? First thing I did was I said, I really need to do a food sensitivity panel, and I really want to do a stool test. And she said, you're crazy. And I said, I know, but go with me on this. So she did, and she did have terrible food sensitivities. Within a month of getting some of those out, her numbers dropped by half a point of hemoglobin A1C. And that, for those of you that aren't exposed to that, three-month average hemoglobin of blood sugar, we can count that. Like the red blood cell test, we can count that in blood sugar. So people can't cheat and tell me that, you know, the last 3 days and pass their glucose number. So when I look at that number, normal is anything below 5.5. Traditional medicine lets you get to 6.5 before they call you diabetic, and between 6 and 6.5 is pre-diabetic. In my opinion, if you're pre-diabetic, you're diabetic, right? So your body's not working right. Things are getting inflamed. Dementia is type 3 diabetes now, so why not get rid of that, right? So she came to me with a hemoglobin A1C of 7.6. They told her she needed to go on insulin. She was adamant she didn't want to. Within a month, 6 weeks of going on the gluten-free diet, she had some other things, and plus she also had some gut things that we fixed. Just that, and fixing her nutrients that were low, she was down to 7.1, 6 weeks later. And she thought I was crazy for testing. This is 3 month average. So really, that was only half of the 3 months. So anyway, a year later, she had lost 70 pounds, and she was no longer a diabetic, in my opinion. Can I call her non-diabetic? No. But she is a non-medicated diabetic with a hemoglobin A1C of 5.2. She's non-diabetic. And so she's on our CNN website. Website and CNN interview. You got to check it out. So she had leaky gut, and that was really going into the metabolic syndrome. So Rebecca, so I went through the whole I never forget talks, the gut, because she heals. So nutrient deficiencies were treated. She went on her diet. She had a lot of detoxification things going on, a lot of toxins, a lot of things that came up in her testing that showed that she needed to export those. So we did a lot of work on those. And then we healed her gut. And she also had the bacteria I told you about. She had a lot of stress. She had stress at home, stress at work. Her husband was going through some stuff at work. And so we really worked on that. That was a huge resistance for her. I tell people all the time that people will take a handful of supplements, stand on their head, and you know, I can tell them to ride backwards on the pike on a bike before they'll change their diet or do stress treatment. Or forget it, like me fitting in sleep. So things that you gotta really work on. Her hormones were really, really off also, and it makes sense, 54, right? That's kind of the time. So we did some supporting with that. Within about 6 months, she was down to only one medication. And here she is a couple years later. She just takes that one IV infusion every 6 weeks, and it's about half the dose it was when she started with me. So she's off two of her medications, and she says she feels better now than she did when she was 34. And I just got a thing that came in our, we have everyone fill out a health history form before they come see us so that we can make sure we're a good provider for you. And it was her husband's. So he's going to come our way now, just this week. And Lily, she, as I told you, had that consultation right after me at Children's that day. And her mother basically said, just give us 6 more weeks. Please just give us 6 more weeks. It was Christmas time, so she was hoping to get it, you know, before she went back to school to have that next colonoscopy. They told her they'd give her 2 months, and they'd test her at the March appointment for the colonoscopy, but that if she kept bleeding, she had to come in sooner than that. We did almost all the same things with her. Of course, they were all different things, but the same pattern, because we told you what the algorithm is. By 3 months, she was off all of her medications. She had zero symptoms, and at the colonoscopy 6 months later, she had no signs of UC. But you can't reverse an autoimmune. So these two girls have a completely different future. So I want you guys to inspire anyone that you talk to that even, it isn't not work, right? So getting better isn't easy. I mean, it's easy, but it's a lot of work. You know, it's easy. There's a recipe. You just got to follow it. So no matter how deep the issue is and no matter how long you've struggled with it, the possibility exists for you to become absolutely free, whole, and healthy. Okay? So, that's the end of my
Other than the detox tea, what did you do in order to get rid of, say, the mercury or lead or heavy metal poisoning? And did you check for any kind of other environmental illness, such as mercury poisoning, too, to see if you need to get rid of the, we'll clear the NRF2 pathway by first going after the mold first, if that was an issue? And I guess you do like the HLA, the FDP2 test to see if they have a genetic susceptibility and then go after the heavy metal.
You just said a lot of words that everybody in here is going, I don't know what he's talking about. So he's talking a very, very deep evaluation of mold toxicity as well as metal toxicity and different genetic things that can play into that. To these two people in particular, we didn't do that for, but we did things like looking at MTHFR, which some of you may have heard of, which is a big, a lot of people have that. It's a genetic way that our body may have a dysfunction or a SNP in a gene that allows us to use B vitamins, specifically B12 and folate. So for her, Rebecca, she had that, and that was a huge thing for her. For some people, yes, we do those things, but not for these people in particular. So some of the testing that we can do for metals is to look serum-wise, and we can also do a provocative test to see what's stored in some of their body.
And so for actually reading out the metals other than the tea, what was?
Well, so everyone's individual, so it depends on what their metals are. So there may be a different type of a chelation, whether it be herbal. If it's going to be IV, then we don't do IV in our office, and we don't do mold in our office.
Oh, I was asking because I saw that on the slide, mercury, and I was wondering if you did, like, any kind of chelation protocol.
We do some oral chelation, yep.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
It's a quick question. What insurance do you accept?
So our office doesn't accept insurance. However, we do have the deductible. We have the form that you can send in for the deductible. And we also take flex spending and we do payment plans. So all of our patients are able to take that form, send it to their insurance. If they've met their deductible, most people get the money back, if not some of it. And if not, it goes towards their deductible. And the labs are covered, if they're the Quest labs that we do, unless people have a huge lab deductible. And then the ones that are kind of specialized are greatly decreased. So instead of a $700 stool test, it's only $129. And that also can be used for flex spending and deductibles and all that.
You said you didn't do IV chelation for heavy metals, but what are your thoughts about IV chelation?
I think if it's done well and if it's done appropriately for that unique patient, then it's a fine thing. Mm-hmm. I know that Rothfeld Center right here does it, and I trust them. Yep. Yes.
What's gram-negative bacteria? Was that on one of your slides?
Was it?
Gram-negative bacteria.
The leaky gut slide, yeah.
That's probably a little deeper than we want to get here tonight, but there's all different types. So the E. coli is a gram-negative bacteria, so I'm not sure specifically what that slide was talking about. It was more just about the leaky gut and how it affects metabolic syndrome.
It was on the leaky gut slide.
Yeah, on the metabolic syndrome one, yeah.
Okay.
I wanted to clarify something you said because I'm not sure I heard it correctly. About being gluten-free and having less ability to assimilate the nutrients, or was that with regard to celiac?
Specific to celiac.
Okay.
So a celiac person has the propensity to always have a reduction in how they're using their nutrients. Even the best gluten-free person, the younger you are when you're diagnosed, the better you are. So I was diagnosed at 36, my daughter was diagnosed at 4. So hopefully her gut will never have that issue. Clearly it did because we did those labs. So I tell my celiacs, if you're a celiac, you need to make sure you're always getting your labs done and to really make sure you're sort of doing that balancing act. It's not going to be the handful of supplements every day because you're going to change depending upon what your body's doing. But gluten sensitivity people, depending upon how sensitive they are, they can actually act like a celiac. So we have something called, they've discovered something called non-genetic gluten sensitivity, which means that they don't have the gene for it, so they can never turn on those autoimmune type trigger, the numbers for autoimmune, but they do endoscopies that look and act just like celiac. And so we know that there's now a non-genetic one that's out there that is acting as all zonulin driven. Yeah.
EAV testing? Do you ever do EAV testing?
We don't do EAV testing. We usually refer to either Rothfeld or other people.
And what is your feeling on it as far as sorting out what your issues are?
I think it's great. It's just that we don't have a lot. We have a very tiny office, and we don't have enough experience in that one particular thing. So I have no problem with everyone getting as deep down and getting the answers that they can get. I think it's great. You know, and I think the other thing I didn't really touch on with the bug section, I mean, people might have a low-level, mono, a low-level cytomegalovirus, things that are, like, little, but their immune system's so distracted and so overworked that they're kind of over there. Yeah, never mind, a chronic Lyme, those kind of things that are there.
Earlier you talked about chewing being the first stage of digestion. For people who suffer from whatever that condition is where they don't make saliva, I mean, they're not just having dry mouth, they just can't produce any saliva. Is saliva the important key in that, that it stays in your mouth longer than breaks down, or is it just the mechanism of chewing?
Just getting it as small as possible.
Okay.
Yeah, it's like getting it to the point where it's almost liquid. Yep. Yes.
Did you have your removed, and did you have any root canals?
I did, and I did not. Yes, I had them removed, and I did. She asked if I had my amalgams removed, and I did. I went to a dentist that used proper way to do that, and then I did some chelation at home. My own herbal type oral chelation. I did not do IV chelation. And after about a year and a half, I had them retested. And my dentist, who did say he would do it for me, even though he didn't believe in that, got a new dentist who had come in after that. I showed him the before and the after, and he said, I need this. I'm going to a conference this weekend, and I keep telling everybody that this needs to be bigger. And so he took all my labs. So.
What kind of process was that for you?
Should I
have them
removed? Oh, it was so uncomfortable. I had to do it in two different things because I had, like I said, I think I had seven or eight of them, and they were on both sides. And so you're there for an hour and a half. My jaw was, really hurting. I had to get a chiropractor to get the jaw back where it needed to be. It was a little bit of a financial thing on me too. So, but that's why I kind of did it too. So I did the detox between them and after them, and then my numbers have remained to the low. Yes?
When you mentioned dairy as one of the food sensitivities, do you distinguish between, say, the goat and cow and the different caseins? Is it just a blanket all dairy?
So specific to testing, yes. So we have the testing that actually will tell us which is it whey, is it casein, is it oats, is it sheep, is it yogurt, is it where is it in that category. As far as me recommending, so I had a really good example today. She came into me about 6 weeks ago with a positive ANA, which is a marker for sometimes lupus, sometimes other rheumatoid arthritis. It's kind of a vague autoimmune test, and she had all the other things were negative, and she had joint pain. So I told her, while we're waiting on it, just do dairy free, because she also had eczema, and a lot of times eczema is dairy. So she couldn't believe the difference, and her joint pain was completely gone. She had no bloating, which she didn't realize she had bloating before. Her eczema wasn't any better yet, but her dairy didn't really come up that high. So I said, it's your call. Like, this is why I tell you to do it beforehand, to see if it's symptomatology. And so in her, the two things that came up with was milk and casein. So I took her off all of the cow stuff, and then she's going to stay on the goat and sheep a little bit here and there. Yes?
What about psoriasis and psoriatic arthritis? Can you talk with her?
Don't forget the gut, because she heals. It's the same. It's all the same program. So we would go through the same category. We would do your timeline. We would look and see what kind of things come up specific to your body. But anything that's on the skin, psoriasis, especially when it's arthritic, eczema, we have people with rosacea. All of those things are usually gut-mediated.
But if a person has suffered for a long time, is it reversible, or is it just...
Is psoriatic arthritis reversible? I don't know that it's reversible, but we can certainly reduce how bad the symptoms are. Yes. And for sure, make it not get worse would be my first goal.
Is a rash the same as eczema?
No. So eczema is actually usually patchy, and it has a completely different look even under the microscope. So rashes can be a whole bunch of different things. It can be IV, it can be exposure to something that you're getting exposed to on a daily basis. can be even fungal. So.
I have another question. Is Candida an autoimmune?
Candida is not autoimmune. It's a fungus. But the ability to fight it could be part of the autoimmune. So some people are more propensity to have it because their immune system can't fight that fungus, whether that be internal or external. And it could definitely break down the gut lining and really add to that leaky gut. Is that one over there?
I think I heard you say that B12 and anxiety go hand in hand.
Yeah.
So that's like a very low B12 level would indicate maybe a lot of anxiety on the part.
It can come out in that way. Low B12 can come out in sore nerves, like nerve pain. It can come out in brain fog. It can come out in fatigue. It can come out in anxiety. So there's neurotransmitter actual pathways, and that's one of the major players in the actual algorithm.
Okay, I'm thinking of an 11-year-old granddaughter. Her favorite meal is mac and cheese, and she loves bread. And I'm just thinking, I'm wondering if she's getting enough, even though her mother makes her eat a lot of broccoli. But I'm wondering if there's a dietary change that might happen, because she freaks out before big tests and things like that.
So that's magnesium, too. Magnesium is a big player in anxiety as well. Teach her to tap. Has anyone ever heard of tapping?
Mm-hmm.
So go online and look up tapping. They have kid ones. So, yeah, I teach a lot of kids how to tap for tests and sports and stuff.
Thanks.
So we have time for one more question. It's already 20 after.
Just that one question regarding, like, Candida versus parasites and cognitively how they are different and what you find to be effective for parasites when experience any effect on neurotransmitters.
The question is about Candida versus parasites and the different. I couldn't ever speak to how to treat either one because I need to know which one I'm treating. And then whether or not they actually affect the brain, and the answer is yes.
In neurotransmitters?
Yeah.
Both of them.
Yeah, because it's gonna, yeah, you make neurotransmitters in your gut. So people think you make it in the brain, but 85-90% are made in the gut, and it's an algorithm. So you start with what you eat protein-wise, and of course if you're not chewing and you don't have stomach acid and you don't have digestive enzymes, your proteins are going to be minimal, right? And then you go from there, and you need about six different nutrients to get the next neurotransmitter, and about six nutrients to get the next neurotransmitter. Anything in that pathway that's a little bit limited is gonna change your neurotransmitter pathways. I am thrilled you guys are all still awake, especially because it did get hot in here. I really appreciate it, and I have everyone's emails, right? Because I'm gonna send you some really great handouts. You don't have to have your handouts. Thank you so much, everybody.
Thank you.